Well, boys, looks like you started the fun without me.
You're all sick. Every last one of you.
We're going to need a bigger gun.
What's the matter? You scared of things that go boom?
Give me one goddamn reason why I shouldn't blow your goddamn brains all over that goddamn wall.
We'd be progressive, America.
I'm Eric, and across from me is Michael.
My name is Eric, and sitting across from me is Michael. And Michael, we have two films.
Wait, two? Today.
Two films.
So like square root of four?
We're going to have, I don't know what the square root of four
it's
is.
It's the same as the cube root of eight.
I have an engineering computer degree. I don't actually know math.
I don't either.
but just give those things away, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Not 10 films, which we will have next time.
10
so
fucking films.
Hopefully the people listening to this have been watching Friday the 13th films.
Religiously.
Because they have a lot that they need to catch up on. So this is kind of cool. My DVD finally comes out this month.
Yeah.
I know I mentioned this on the show once before, but I shot this concert DVD for some Canadian friends of mine who are in this band called The Birthday Massacre.
Mm-hmm.
Basically the deal here, I made this DVD. I only made like 25 of them or something. And it was just for myself and to give to them and some mutual friends of ours. And I made a making of feature and put it online. And the response to that was just enormous. I ended up talking to their manager and we worked out this deal to distribute the DVD for free online. So I've been slowly putting up stuff for that over the past year. And now it is finally, it's all up there. You can download it for free. I'm really excited about that. You can get it at tbmchicago.com. And there's like a download link or something. Other thing that's happening this month that's really cool is Music Box Massacre 4.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about that more later. So you have a little story about how we almost didn't get to watch these films today. What are the two films?
Well, the two films today are Autofocus, mm-hmm. which is my film, your choice, and From Hell, which is your film, my choice.
Great.
So a little background on why...
Actually, we almost didn't have either of these films.
Yeah. So a little background on why this podcast almost didn't happen today. Because you were sleeping, I was forced to take a walk around your neighborhood.
It was one in the afternoon. I mean, come on.
One in the afternoon. We were walking and this man, as we approached him, sitting at a bench, shouted,
Chinch.
Hey, what CD is that?
Oh no.
And I'm like, it's a DVD. And he's like, what is it? He's weird. And I'm like, oh, it's Autofocus. And he's like, oh really? Can I see it? And
wow.
And I was like, no. And I showed it to him. And he's like, hey, yeah, who's that guy? I'm like, Greg Kinnear. And he's like, yeah. And he was really excited about Autofocus.
Wow.
Almost as excited as you should be to talk about it right now. But before we do that.
We're going to spoil both of these films.
Hardcore spoilage.
And not like spoiling the story you just told.
Right.
But we are actually going to talk about the content of said films.
Yeah.
If you have not seen the films, probably be a good idea not to listen to the show.
Right.
People are just kind of
listen
like,
anyway.
Yeah, they're going to ignore every time I say that, every single show, and they're just going to listen. Yeah. They'll be like, yay,
one time you
talking.
Should switch it up and say you should just listen to it anyway.
Yeah.
Don't make that today. Make it hit your Punisher.
No, I don't know about that. There, right. We have bad films we can do that for.
Yeah.
Autofocus being the first film.
You want to field it?
Start we have to talk about Greg first. He's fucking awesome in this.
Greg Kinnear.
So I had to kind of do a double take because I didn't realize it was the guy from The Matador.
Mm-hmm.
Darker hair, darker eyes. I don't know what it was, but so right away.
No glasses, no mustache.
Yeah. Yeah. No glasses, no mustache is maybe what it was. We go into the radio thing.
Yeah.
Turns out he has a radio voice.
Yep.
I didn't realize that until just then. And through the rest of the movie, that didn't really sink in so much either. But being on the radio, total radio. Mm-hmm. Do we have radio voices?
You do.
I have a little bit of a radio
totally
voice.
Don't.
I just giggle less. I think it's what it
you
is.
You giggle less than I
this
do.
This is me containing my giggle.
Right. And then
if you
I
would
just...
like to hear said giggle, you should watch... what were those two films? You should watch The Singing Detective and 28 Monkeys Later.
28 Monkeys Later. This film has not yet had 28 monkeys.
Other people in this film that were notable William Dafoe.
Willem Dafoe.
What did I just say?
William.
I don't think he'd be offended by that.
I don't think
so. This movie has kind of a dark turn towards, I would say, the later half, maybe the later third.
Later third, probably.
So I'm going to do my best to talk about the lighter part of the movie before we go into that. Just notable things. So that first strip club scene is awesome. I love that like lounge jazz stuff.
The late 60s.
Yeah, the like, smoky stuff. Mm-hmm. I like it. And it was a lot different than, so he ends up playing in a bunch of strip clubs, but they don't all have quite that feel to them. Got to find places like that in Chicago because I love that stuff. Well, I have to make them.
All right. And
something I wanted to ask you about is they start doing these tapes of different sexual acts or filming themselves having sex with girls or putting their fingers in each other's butts. And I thought I could get through that whole thing without laughing, but I couldn't.
Just brings back memories.
When they I don't even know what that's supposed to mean. When they first show one of the tapes, it's censored.
That's a little later. I wouldn't say that's the first time.
Well,
they
it's
show
the
it.
First time they show one of them in the tapes.
Mm-hmm.
What up with that?
All right. Well, I can't honestly see them like editing it in the film.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense within the context of the film.
Yeah, the film is all about, you know, sex is, this is not, I mean, you could take it one of two ways. The film kind of portrays, it's kind of this dichotomy between the type of person that thinks sex is completely normal mm-hmm. and the type of like this social structure that says that sex is this weird, kinky thing
a taboo
in and of itself.
Yeah, right.
And I'm willing to bet that, and I'm really glad that we covered this film has not yet been rated at this current date earlier in this podcast, because I think that this is just a case of like the film being submitted.
Right.
And then being like, in order to get an R rating, you're going to have to censor it.
Do you think that's what it was?
I'm willing to bet that. I mean, it's an R rated film already. And it's for in every sense of the word.
Yeah.
I mean, fuck ratings, but it's R rated.
Yeah.
And there's no reason for it not to be by the standards.
So do you think it's the kind of thing that you think they filmed all of that stuff, they were ready to put it in, and then they just couldn't get by with the rating?
Sure.
Because I have a feeling, well, at first I had a feeling they just didn't want, you know, the two stars of the film to feature nudity
itself. I think those were body doubles.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Well, sometimes you see faces.
Yeah, but I mean, only in certain scenarios.
From behind you don't. And from behind they also don't show the nudity, they don't censor the nudity, rather. But that, again, could be the body double thing or the choice of the ratings board being that, like, naked male ass, totally okay.
Yeah. Blowjob, not cool.
Yeah. Blowjob, not cool. Tits everywhere, totally fine.
Tits everywhere.
Blowjob, not cool.
Tits are great.
There was that speech.
The speech.
Which is pretty, I love small nipples. That's not the point of this show, but I just had to interject that. No, it's pretty great.
Anything else you want to interject in small nipples?
Also the dominatrix later. Pretty fantastic. I like how they credited her later in the-
Melissa / Mistress Victoria.
Yeah, that was pretty great.
So anyway, back to the tit speech.
The small nipples? No, the tit speech. Oh, wow. Tits speech. You compared that to Spun.
Spun. I would say the scene in Spun is probably better just for its novelty.
Well, and it's Mickey Rourke.
Well, yeah. Plus he whips around and he's dressed as Uncle Sam and the American flag drops behind him. And then you have the
was
the
that Spider-Man 3 or was that Spun?
Because
I kind of remember that scene
time
from
in Mexico.
Okay. Well, I kind of remember that scene from Spider-Man 3.
Yeah, I think there was something going on.
Shortly following the tit speech, there's another thing I really liked. And so this gets back to what you were talking about before with the different treatments of sex as like one is a taboo and the other is perfectly normal and healthy.
Yeah.
And as total extremes, right? When treated as a taboo, it's treated as just having sex is like this crazy, disgusting thing. And then the other side is that the most kinky, perverse, open sexual orgies are like totally okay.
Finger up
and,
the asshole.
Right. Totally okay and normal in all possible contexts. So they have this kind of like open relationship. I guess it becomes open marriage speech when he's talking to Patty, I think was her name, right? So he had mentioned to her earlier that he wanted someone who understood him.
Mm-hmm.
And then she tells him that, you know, she knows about the other women and the pictures and whatever, and she's totally okay with it.
Yeah.
And it's this really cool moment. It's this great, open, honest thing. And then they cut immediately from that scene. Do you remember the very next scene? Willem Dafoe like totally womanizing?
Oh, well,
It cuts right to the, man, you know, these women are great, but you got to listen about their shoes and their shopping and pretend to be interested in them. it's like I was in such a warm, happy place after the Patty dialogue, and then it ruined everything.
Yeah.
Total buzzkill. Which, speaking of total buzzkill,
the second third of the film, I guess the final third, the second third was
the second of the three thirds.
The second of the three thirds.
So there's such a dramatic shift in mood here.
Yeah.
And
it's really hard to pinpoint when that is.
Well,
I think it's possibly maybe the scene where he goes into his agent that last time.
I would say right before that.
Right before that.
Here's the thing. Here's what I had a little trouble swallowing with this is there's a line that I think is drawn. It's not so gradual. It's gradual in the context of the entire film.
Yeah.
And for you seeing that, I can see where you, because it gets way worse is my point than you think it's going to get.
Yeah.
The film takes itself very lightly.
It starts as fucking high as a film can start.
Yeah. Right.
It starts.
Even from the credits.
It starts full house good.
Yeah.
You know? And then.
I don't say full house good.
Okay. It's full house positive.
Right. Okay.
It starts full house positive.
Is that
positive. Anything
like HIV positive?
Similar, only it kills you faster. then it goes down to tripod negative, which is when you realize you don't have tripod
anymore. When you fucking bludgeon someone in the face with your tripod. I didn't know it was going there. How could you know that it was going there?
You can't know.
So you're like, oh, this film's just taking kind of a dark slide down into, you know, the fucking downward spiral, right? Yeah. To make another Trent Reznor reference.
Yeah.
And I wasn't aware it was going to go that far down. So I was like, well, that was a bad gradual shift because there was none.
Yeah. I would argue that, and just, this is kind of an aside, but the part at the end, Bob Crane gets murdered.
And has also been dead the entire time.
And has been dead the whole time. But I would argue that it's one of the most violent things in film. Like the way they did it. They show it. They show him get hit in the head.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
That's worse than some of the things we're going to see Friday the 13th.
So they hint at it. I want to talk about the transition before we even really kind of talk about what happens in that segment. But they hint at it a little bit when he's on the set filming and he kind of goes into bizarre dream world. Everything is
Everybody's got a mustache.
Right out the window. Yeah, bizarro world, really. And that's the first time that there's really like... The first time the film looks kind of dark itself, the score changes up a little bit and the score gets like fucking weird toward the end.
Yeah. Especially like when he's swimming in the pool.
Yeah.
That's really when the score swells up and kind of like you don't feel comfortable with the film anymore.
Which is what you want. Exactly. You know, I make it sound sometimes when we talk about uncomfortable film as if it's bad and it's not, it's awesome.
Oh,
it's
great.
Fantastic. Yeah. But it doesn't make you feel really uncomfortable, especially after everything was fun and good.
I think the director's name is Paul Schrader, I'm pretty sure. Mm-hmm. But I mean, I've never like consciously seen anything else he's done.
Uh-huh.
But
might be time to do that.
It takes fucking talent to start a film with like lounge jazz 101 Dalmatians opening credits.
Yeah.
And then end the film with Guys Gotta Have Fun with a clip of Bob Crane's corpse bludgeoned to death.
Yeah.
In a bed.
So they do a couple things to change the mood. And I'm really interested in how they do this because it's almost, and I pointed out when they started doing, so the scene, the very scene for me that it was when the shift happened is when he's doing the like making bacon with Macon section, you know, the little cooking segment.
Yeah.
If you have South Park DVDs, you know what's up. Yeah. So they have this little cooking thing and I remember saying to you, like, what do you think that was like a second unit thing? That's kind of weird. That looked visually very different.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of the first real transition moment, I think. So they do a couple things here. I'm really concerned from a technical angle how you pull this off in film and how you upset people so much. And I think one of it is Steadicam stuff or maybe even like Handycam kind of stuff. Like there's a lot of the scenes before this were... tripod, which maybe they used the tripod to beat him to death, which is why
that's probably the change.
Right.
They're like, we don't need this anymore.
But that just naturally makes people feel uneasy because you don't have a steady focus from which to watch the film. You don't have a steady point.
The other thing they did, I'm guessing you're going to touch on it, but I'm just going to pull it out from under you. They did a lot of like weird angles with the camera, like especially like probably most obviously in the scene where Carpi is talking to him on the phone. That scene is probably the most uncomfortable for me.
Well, yeah.
Because he's like talking and he's like half crying and uncomfortable and touching himself. And it's Willem Dafoe who, when creepy, is as creepy as can be.
As humanly possible.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and that is not only the angles, but the focus and the content of the frame, really. I mean, they go from his eyes to his mouth to his hand and his crotch, and things are just like going out of focus and back into focus. And they do a little bit of that, and I think you see that the most in that scene. The other thing is color.
Yeah.
Color and focus, but in a different way than we were just talking about. Stuff is given a really hard focus. Mm-hmm. It's like a 28 Weeks Later did that a lot. With that really sharp kind of contrast.
Yeah.
But contrast and depth of field, not contrast. This is getting really technical. I'm sorry. Very clear details.
Yeah.
Before that, it was a bit of a softer focus, lighter on skins, well, that kind of stuff.
It had like the 60s feel.
Yeah, exactly. Like, and then it got grittier.
Yep.
Basically, what you notice is it feels grittier. Mm-hmm. That's done by sharper focus, I think. But that it feels grittier.
Yeah.
And then the colors too, like stuff got a little more desaturated. All the skin tones were a little whiter. Yeah. Everything felt a little more drained.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, part of the reason I didn't feel like it was gradual, because I knew when the mood shift, like when that point had happened.
Right.
Just by visually how it looked, and then the score too. Mm-hmm. But man, what a buzzkill. Yeah. What a downer.
So there's a few things I want to touch on, but so first off, I just kind of want to just bring up real quick and see how you feel about it. But aside from the fact that, I mean, I'm assuming you enjoyed the film.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Okay.
This might be another keeper.
Yeah, this is a really good film. And it's just some film I randomly found at a store. And I'm like, hey, Greg Kinnear.
Wow, really?
Picked it up. Yeah.
Man.
So what I want to talk about is the fact that it's a true story.
Yeah. Which I didn't, you know, that I remember saying that to you when the film ended too, was going, wow. So they kind of did the like revisionist history or alternate history thing there. And you're like, no, that really happens.
Yep.
It's like, whoa.
Yeah. So basically the only question I want to bring up to you is just, I'm wondering, and this kind of feeds into the next thing I want to bring up, but how do you feel about a celebrity that's kind of like put into infamy due to something like sex versus, you know, the way the film felt was like a drug spiral film, kind of Requiem for a Dream.
Yeah, I got that feel from it. Happy,
and then everybody starts getting into their shit.
But right.
The difference between this and Requiem for a Dream is Requiem for a Dream really paints meth is bad.
Yeah.
And this is like, hey, he's having sex and look at his life.
It's more, man, yeah, this is definitely going to be a film I own. So I noticed that a lot, again, from a visual standpoint, as I was watching, as it felt a little bit like Requiem for a Dream. They used a little bit of the same technique. And I don't agree with sort of the moral of the story in Requiem.
I don't know if that is the moral of the story.
I don't know. Well, that's debatable. But here I think it's a little more clear in that it's ambiguous, if that makes any sense.
Right.
It's more clear that the point is to be ambiguous, I think. And I like that a bit more because it's less black and whites, you know, it's kind of stuff in the middle. And I think just from a thematic standpoint, I enjoy that a lot more.
Yeah. I really like, the whole, like, this is not necessarily a bad thing,
right?
But anything in excess can ruin.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, And I'm wondering, and this is the question I wanted to pose before, is I'm wondering, do you think that had something to do with the fact that he had, you know, this wholesome celebrity, and that's kind of what brought him down because of the whole sex thing? Like, for example, we have Paris Hilton now, who's fucking whatever, who cares? But everybody knows she has sex.
Yeah.
And she's still a celebrity.
Right.
But do you think if Bob Crane was the type of guy everybody knew he fucked around, do you think that his celebrity would have maintained, you know, some kind of status?
It's a little bit harder because of the era of film
and specifically
television. Yeah, that's what I mean is there were a lot more wholesome roles on TV.
But I mean, he got away with German POW camp.
Yeah,
I mean, that went what, number three and number one of the new shows that year.
Yeah.
But sex apparently
worse than World War II. Yeah. I don't know. You know, there's that kind of other thing too that they dealt with in this movie, which is trying to move on past the role you've become famous for.
Yeah, this film touches on a lot of stuff.
It really does. And that's a really interesting idea to me as someone who makes stuff. You know, it's like you always want your projects to get big, but sometimes you fall into something that becomes huge and then you're worried that that's going to define you.
Right.
And it was interesting to see, because a couple people, as we've been mentioning to other people, we know that this is, you know, sometimes people ask us what the next double feature is or whatever, which you can find on the site, by the way. Rather than talking to us and trying to be our friends, you should just use our website.
Yeah. That's what we built it for. To eliminate personal contact.
But everyone's like, oh, isn't that the movie with the Hogan's Heroes guy? So in the back of my mind, and I didn't even remember that really, but as soon as they dropped the Hogan's Heroes
guy that wanted to steal my DVD knew.
Yeah. Oh. So I kind of figured most of the movie would be about that. And it really isn't. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a little bit about that. Maybe one of the thirds.
Yeah.
But not necessarily, you know, a back-to-back third. It's just content-wise. They maybe deal with that for about a third of the film. And the rest of the film is kind of him trying to find out what the rest of his life is and pick up stuff and hold it together. So this is a brutal ending to this film, which is brutal by contrast of really the content of the rest of the film. The rest of the film is really like pornographic.
Kind
of,
yeah.
Well, as far as like what's going to be controversial about the film.
Yeah.
As far as I imagine the people in the MPAA sitting down with their notepads and their popcorn and their... fucking old. They are so old.
Their age.
What was I saying?
They're sitting their age and their 20-year-old kids.
Right. And they're bifocals. And I'm offending everyone right now. I'm really sorry about that. People are trifocals.
They've invented
trifocals. I have
glasses
on right now. It's okay.
And
but not tripods.
Pants.
Okay. So what I was saying was, is they're taking notes and they're like, oh, sex, woman getting pleasure, you know, censor, censor, censor. And then the last scene, when they're just like,
space, rated R.
And then you get to the last scene. It's like, oh yeah, there's violence too. Yeah. Whoops. Didn't see that
That's
coming.
That's not on the actual, like, you know, the little fucking rating where it has like R in the square. And
well,
then
maybe they're
it,
not offended by it. Cause
under
violence
it,
is
it has
okay.
the reasons.
Yeah.
Violence not in there.
Right. Woman taking control of their own bodies. Is that in the, like female empowerment? Is that in the little box?
Yeah, female empowerment.
Okay. Rated R for female empowerment.
Yeah. Also normalcy.
It's violent by contrast of other things, which... Have you seen A History of Violence?
No.
A History of Violence does that really good, where it's a little, it's a weird film, and I've only seen
it
once, but it's kind of bland, and like every, you know, 20 or 30 minutes, there's just like some kind of big squib hit, you know, something really like in this film where you have, well, this is particularly is a bludgeoning, but you have that kind of blood spatter against the wall kind of thing. And the fact that it you haven't seen any of that, the context of that is really what makes that work. Mm-hmm. And I love that a lot. Yeah. What a great way to end a film. That and a creepy quote.
I think with this film, it shows a guy that, I mean, I think you're willing to accept is he's just an innocent guy. Like, he never did anything wrong.
I almost thought they did that to a fault even, whereas they're kind of dragging him into this, like, this orgy-tastic world. Yeah. He kind of seemed a little too, like... the unwilling participant who accidentally like he has no sin. He's just this guy who accidentally fucks around behind his wife. But I see where you're going.
Yeah.
With
it's
that.
Just this guy who it's this guy who's totally not sex obsessed and he just kind of innocently falls into this, you know, sexual world. And I think we're going to see an absolute opposite of that with From Hell.
From Hell kind of features a guy who's sucked into sin, I guess, from the opening shot. I mean, the opening shot is him getting high in the little opium bar place, Steely. Well, the film's not really about that.
That's... No, not even close. Nor is the film about sex in any way, shape, or form.
Not really.
Except for the fact that there are prostitutes.
Yeah, and somehow still not about sex.
Not at all.
This is a double feature of surprises today. I think I picked up a film, and I think maybe I lost a film.
Yeah.
I should point out that I haven't seen this since I was like 15 or 16.
Yeah.
Well, maybe earlier than that. And I think I saw it the once, and I'm pretty sure I still own it.
Yeah.
So
you should not.
What do you want to tell me about this film? This is going to turn into me defending why I have this film.
Is it?
Yeah, because there's, and I think you probably know the reason if you just think about it hard enough. This also gives us an opportunity to talk about Freemasons.
So going into this film, I was really hoping that I would like it. And then
sorry about that.
Started disappointing me really early. And then I started trying to think of like ways where I could be like, surprise, I still like this film. But
you come up with any of those?
No.
I didn't think so.
I wanted to, but there's too much Shaggy and Scooby action.
Yeah.
Too many contact lenses.
So the film does a lot of no-nos in film. Not necessarily for all genres and all audiences, but I think between the two of us, they probably hit every stupid film thing
pretty
possible.
Much. Yeah.
So you have a Freemason conspiracy.
Freemason conspiracy.
Which is always good when it ends in a conspiracy. Because, you know, so frequently, isn't that Occam's razor, right? That just select the conspiracy? Isn't that how that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I believe that's how that tool works. And then we also have... the whodunit.
The whodunit.
Right.
Which we should call the Scooby-Doo.
All right, cool. So yeah, we have the Scooby-Doo there. And there's... So this film does the misleading thing where it like tries to make you think it's the one guy and then it turns out to be the other guy.
All of them.
it kind of goes half fuzz on you a little bit. Yeah.
Where it's whodunit. It's everyone done it.
Right. Yeah.
Everyone except the living statue.
Was there anything redeeming about this for you?
Johnny Depp's accent.
Yeah. It was pretty good.
Really fucking good. It's possibly his best, like actually like British accent because it seemed really authentic, especially among other British actors. However, Heather Graham's British accent. No.
Well, all of the women, I think their British accents were pretty bad.
I think some of them might
It might be harder for a girl to do a British accent.
Too. Why?
I don't know. It's just more
because
rare.
Because you're more of a stickler for women with British accents.
Yeah, maybe that's it.
Because you're not looking for male British accents to be attractive.
You know, I don't know. I don't know if that's it or not. I think it's just kind of the, I don't know. Even when I hear actual women with like, maybe not actual women with British accents. Let me phrase that properly. Women with actual British accents, whether they are actual women or not.
Right.
Even some of their British accents sound bad to me. I don't know why.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't know what causes that. That's not the point.
No, British accents is not the point of this film.
A couple redeeming things.
A couple?
Yeah, I think there are buried inside of, and you hit on what they were. This is one of those films that I wish I could fault it for being 2 hours. I could just be like, well, you see, it's bad because it's 2 hours because we've hit a few of those.
Yes.
But if this film were an hour, it would still be awful.
Probably worse.
You think so?
Yeah. They wouldn't have had enough time for all the explanation of the twists that confuse you. Also grapes.
Yeah, the grapes thing, I could have dealt with it a little bit, but they just kept bringing it up.
Like, hey, look at this. Is that a plus for the film?
is that a redeeming point that grapes looked tasty?
Maybe.
Man, you can really tell listening to these when we hit on a film we just don't care about at all.
I can.
I'm sorry. Can we just pause for a second while I point out that you just pointed out how... you just brought up how tasty the grapes looked in this film.
Sorry, dude.
All right, but there is more. There's things we can say about this. One I wanted to point out. So we mentioned a little bit in autofocus about how I thought it was like...
Hey, autofocus.
Right. yes. So we can do that. How it was revisionist history or alternate history, which I kind of liked.
Which you were wrong.
Which it turned out, not to be at all. But this kind of went the other way.
Completely.
Where they took little bits of the Jack... This was based on the graphic novel.
Okay.
And they took...
What was the graphic novel called?
It was... I want to say it's Alan Moore. I don't know what it was called.
Okay.
It might have been called From Hell.
Okay. Well, we need to get back to the titular line also.
Oh, yeah. Well, let's hit on that right now I go into my...
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure it's Alan Moore.
All right.
Didn't Alan Moore do Watchmen? I wish I knew comics better than I pretend.
The titular line delivery in this film... is possibly the worst we've seen so far.
Yeah.
And it's doubled by the fact that a tagline follows it. They get a letter from Jack the Ripper, who earlier in the film has done the, what we would call the Silence of the Lambs version of the titular line.
Right.
Where Dr. Jekyll, the driver, says something about hell, and Jack the Ripper's response is, "I am hell," which, despite the grammatical error and the fact that a person cannot be a place, stands as a grammatical sentence.
Right.
However, later in the film, they get a letter from Jack the Ripper, who, previously denoting himself as hell, signs it. Are you ready? From hell.
Very nice.
Which is then proceeded.
So you don't know if it's like a postcard, like, hey, greetings from Alabama, or hello, I am Alabama. Yeah. Right. Okay, good.
Yeah, exactly.
Which became a mystery throughout the film.
Whether or not he was Alabama.
Right.
And then the from hell signature is preceded by the groin-grabbing line, at least they got the address right.
Nice. Yeah. It had to be one of the most painful ones yet.
Yeah. Also, I want to get into the poor montage quality of this film.
Please.
So this film does something that we've not seen with montages in our search, our quest, be it for a good montage, which we've actually found a few of.
Sure.
This film does something unheard of in the art of montage.
Which is what?
It montages events that will happen later in the film.
Right.
And splices them together with stock footage of the sets and suspicious looks from all of the characters, and then somebody gets cut up.
Let's get into the supernatural detective elements of this film a little bit.
All right.
How do you feel about, as a premise, the supernatural detective?
I watched The Great Mouse Detective as a kid.
Uh-huh.
And the premise of a mouse solving crime was more believable than this.
So part of this comes from, and this goes back to the comic book thing I wanted to talk about, but the liberties you can take when adapting from a comic book and how you have to think about that when you're making a film that people aren't aware is a adaptation from a graphic novel.
Or a poor film.
Well, that's the thing, right? Is that if, like, you look at something like any of the new Marvel films or like...
Iron Man?
Yeah, Iron Man's a good example. Iron Man is, well, it's so obviously just by the title a comic book movie. Mm-hmm. Sin City, I think, because of how stylized it is. Yeah. And you know it's a comic book film, right. You know, going in. This, you don't know that about it. And it's funny, all the things it tried to do in kind of separate ways, but like... as you pointed out, like ball grabbing tagline after titular line is okay if you're like doing the Fantastic Four.
Right.
You know what I mean? And things like Supernatural Detective, you don't even think twice about it if it's like, well, you know, some comic book movie.
And this,
if this was Spawn.
Yeah.
The fact that we're talking about hell all the time and supernatural powers.
And postcards from Alabama.
Right. No one would care.
And it parallels Constantine in that way, where Constantine, for whatever reason, doesn't want to paint itself as a comic book movie. Yeah. And sometimes that's the best way to go about being given the liberties that you're trying to take with a film.
Because otherwise you end up with a film people think is a historical representation of Jack the Ripper.
And that's what I expected, which is why I,
not a whodunit mystery,
I would like
about.
To go back and retroactively address that this film does not in any way have like a... opposite sex, you know, good guy, bad guy sex thing to the autofocus. They're not related.
Oh, yeah, right.
I thought there would be like this, hey, Jack the Ripper was this sex-driven maniac who killed people, and Bob Crane was this nice guy who got drawn into this underbelly of sex.
We were hoping for a sexy double feature, and it didn't happen.
Sexy double feature did not happen.
There actually was kind of a downer double feature.
So little sex.
So in the Supernatural thing, we also have to talk about absinthe a little bit.
Do we?
We do, I think.
All right.
Because you get this idea, and they do this, there were a couple parallels to Carnival. I know we talk about Carnival every once in a while.
Yeah.
You know, loads and the absinthe in Carnival. There's this idea that absinthe gives you magic powers. Yeah. I don't know if you're familiar with this.
I'm not.
Aside from all the Illuminati Freemason bullshit that was going on.
Yeah.
And the fairy thing, and which, you know, we can address later. There's also this idea that like maybe because he was so high, he could get high and solve crimes.
Yeah.
And that's not how
it's
that
like,
works.
It's like, dude, where's my car?
Yeah. Well, yeah, actually, I've not seen that film, but I'm going to.
Neither have I.
All right. Let's assume.
I'm just assuming. Here's what I'm assuming, dude, where's my car is. They wake up and their car is missing. So they get really stoned and then that helps them find it.
Well, of course. Okay. Naturally, I'm pretty sure that's what. I've never been stoned. I have, however, had absinthe, which looks awesome on film. And because absinthe looks really awesome. Turns out, and so I know you saw this study this year too, but absinthe doesn't have hallucinogenic properties.
Yeah.
It just has, turns out, a lot of alcohol in it.
Yep.
You get really drunk and then you drop your grapes.
So aside from puddle grapes, this movie had one other really good aspect. And this is something that I'm just bringing up now because of what we're going to do later with the Friday the 13th-a-thon.
Killapalooza, if you will.
Yeah, Jason Fest, whatever. This film is a really, if you want to look at it this way, it's a really stylized slasher film.
Yeah.
All of the like violence and everything is
You've hit on it. I was going to wait until you came up with it, but that's the reason that I enjoy this.
Oh, yeah?
And so you noticed a couple of times I was writing down timestamps in my little notepad here. There are things this does, this movie does from a stylistic point of view that are really, really cool. There's only like, what, five of them maybe, but they're worth, and I might just chop them out of the movie and save them on my computer somewhere or something.
Yeah.
God, I love digital copies.
The best,
movies.
I think the best thing.
I don't even need
to
own this whole film. Yeah. I can just take out the five good scenes and have them.
The best thing that the film did that I liked was when the first prostitute got killed and he just pulled her into the dark alley and you just see the knife
stab
five times from different angles and it gets bloodier every time.
See, I liked from an execution standpoint and not from a story standpoint at all.
Execution pun intended?
No. I'm not clever enough for that. The second one that's killed, there's the time lapse of the officers standing around the body.
Yeah.
Now, this is a notable time lapse. In a normal time lapse, you have a steady camera shot on a tripod or whatever, and you let it run for some ridiculous amount of time, and then you speed up the film. Simple, easy.
Mm-hmm.
This one, however, moves kind of forward and through the street as the time lapse is going on, which that's ridiculous and awesome.
Yeah.
There's a couple things this film does right visually that I really like. It's green and red. It's a green and red film, which is kind of strange.
I didn't like that.
Neither do I, but I admire that someone tried to mix those colors.
I also really didn't like—
And not look like Christmas.
You noted it in the beginning that the orange sky was cool, but when they showed it a second time, it looked really fake.
It was laughable.
But I mean, have you ever thought about orange? Like, what is it?
I like the desaturated city a lot too, when it was kind of— it's not even necessarily that it was desaturated so much as it just had this like starky—
a lower amount of saturation.
It had this kind of starky feel to it. Is starky a word? Starky's not the word I'm looking for.
Starky is actually part of Iron Man.
Tony Starky?
Yeah.
You know, it had this kind of comic book feel to it, which was one of the only things in the film that felt like a comic book. Outside of the like Marilyn Manson video, I got high and I'm going to solve a crime scenes.
Yeah.
Which, you know, those are always good too. What about the ending here?
Which one?
Okay, not the ending where...
the Bruce Willis ending?
Yeah, the Bruce Willis ending. It's not a Bruce Willis ending.
Well, he dies.
Yeah, but okay, so I don't even want to leave speculation here. It wasn't a dream. Now, people are going to say this, and you probably give audiences more respect for this than to allow yourself to believe that they might say this, but the fact that he was in the same kind of place at the end of the film... As to the beginning,
probably the same place.
Immediately leads people to think, what if it was just a dream?
It wasn't.
I'm sure if you go on like IMDb or Wikipedia.
I can explain exactly how it's not a dream.
But you will at least admit that people are probably saying this somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
There's some audience somewhere who, they're wrong.
Yeah.
Like most times people go, it's just a dream.
I can explain exactly how you know it's not a dream. The film ends with the, you know, 2 pence in Johnny Depp's hand.
Right.
Which he addresses after being woken up the first time to the guy who did not know what it meant.
Right.
And therefore him putting it on the eyes.
The fairy thing. The idea is that you have to pay the fairy man to get into.
Like when I heard fairy, I thought like little people with wings.
Yeah, no.
Okay.
No, like garden fairies.
Yeah. Those.
No, you have to pay the fairy man to, you know, get into heaven or whatever. Turns out whether or not you pay the fairy man, you're still not going to get into heaven.
Yeah.
So the end of the film is just null for me.
Well, I don't know. He gets some quarters on it.
Yeah, but he had the quarters in his pocket before that. Plus, I don't know if you knew this, but when you're dead, you can't actually spend quarters. What are we watching next time? Keep in mind, you never have to see From Hell again.
I will never see.
Although I might make you watch certain scenes when we go to do that film thing we're doing. I can't wait to talk about that, by the way.
What?
I'm not going to do that because there's a microphone in front of me, but you know that film thing we're doing?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That'll be good.
Okay. Sorry. Films, next time. Two of them.
Next time... We're going to do, first we're doing the big, you know, slasher-a-thon special. It's had like 10 names on this show alone. Yeah. The big slasher special.
Right.
Super Sunday
See
fudge.
All of the Friday the 13th movies. Yeah. With the
1 through Jason X.
Right.
We're not doing Freddy versus Jason.
We're going to wait till I do the Freddy movies first.
So we'll be doing that next time. We're going to watch all of the films and podcasts once. And then after that, we're doing, finally, Hitcher and Punisher.
Great.
For the Here double feature.
So if you live in Chicago, the Music Box is this theater downtown here. We talked about it before on the This Film Is Not Yet Rated podcast as a theater you should support that does, you know, cool different runs of stuff.
Yeah.
I won't rehash all the reasons that you should support those things right now, but I think they're plentiful and you can go back and listen to that show to hear that whole rant. But they do this annual thing called Music Box Massacre. They're doing the 4th one this year. And it's basically, it's a 24-hour horror marathon, which is awesome. And something that if you listen to the show, you're probably into. They're going to have a couple directors who are actually going to be there. The director of Friday the 13th, the final chapter, which we're going to talk about next week. Mm-hmm. Joseph Zito, I believe is his name. And then the director of May, a film we're both really into. Lucky McKee, who also did Masters of Horror. And then they're doing the Chicago premiere of a film we both couldn't find anywhere. We were thinking about going to see it in Wisconsin, actually. First time it's premiering in Chicago, Midnight Meat Train, which is directed by Clive Barker, who will be there. He also did Hellraiser and some other stuff. I'm really excited about that film. It looks cool. Maybe we'll talk about it on the show. But they're doing a lot of films. They're playing Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. They're playing White Zombie, which is that Bela Lugosi movie that Rob Zombie's older band was named after. Old Dark House, Eyes Without a Face, that Jax Brooks movie you're all excited about, Monster Slayer, Pieces, Black Sabbath, The Exorcist, and Peter Jackson's Dead Alive, which I don't think I've seen any of those. So tickets are $27 or $33 at the door. You can get them online. The website is musicboxtheater.com. This is a really cool thing they're doing. I think people should support it. I really want people to go. There's free monster drinks, which is a cool reason to show up. And it's like, it's 24 hours. It's October 25th at noon. So buy a ticket and go to that.
Watch more fucking film.
Bye. I'm going to have to edit that out too.
I'm sorry.
You should be fucking sorry.